Welcome back to our election 2018 special. It's our Democratic candidates for governor primary election forum that we're doing here at Jacksonville University. Our next interview is with Mr. Jeff Greene. 30 seconds now for an opening comment, sir.
Well, thank you, Jacksonville University, for having me. Thank you, Kent. Just briefly, grew up in New England, started my family, lost everything when I was a kid, had to work my way through Johns Hopkins, Harvard Business School, but it was a great public education, great student loans, all the opportunities that I had from a great social safety net that got me to where I am today. I'll never forget the obligation I have to public education and to make a pathway for every Floridian.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So let's start here. I know you've never held elected office. You haven't been a high-ranking official in the government.
No.
The only president in our history with that background is the current one, Donald Trump. So is this a disadvantage to you in terms of seeking to hold an office of governor with that lack of elected office experience?
Well, not really. I mean, Kent, you know, Florida right now is in a state of emergency. I mean, our education is 40th in the country, according to U.S. News and World Report. Our health care is 48th in the country. Our schools are not safe. We know that. Our environment, I mean, Lake Okeechobee is choking on toxic blue-green algae. We've got big problems in the state. And you know what? We need someone as a leader, a fearless fighter for Florida who can basically, you know, can be a progressive and can solve complex problems. I've been solving complex problems my whole life. And I believe that I'm ready to tackle these problems better than anyone else in this race.
So one of the things you've been doing so far is spending some time and money attacking President Donald Trump. I guess why is that relevant in a Democratic primary? I mean, clearly everyone in the Democratic primary opposes Donald Trump.
Well, look, Donald Trump is—he's a national embarrassment. I'm ashamed to have him as our president, and I can tell you that, you know, when I see these kinds of things he's doing—just, you know, tearing young kids out of their mothers' arms at the borders, you know, the way he conducts himself with Charlottesville, you know, inciting racism and bigotry, it upsets me, and I think that upsets most Democrats. And so, you know, Florida needs someone who can stand up to him. And I'm the kind of person who can stand up to him, and I will when I'm governor of Florida.
So just be brief on this, 30 seconds or less. How is that related to Florida issues? Because I think what we're hearing from people is, hey, I want to know these candidates. If they want to be my governor, I want to know that they're concerned with what happens in Florida.
Well, sure. Well, look, Donald Trump has talked about, you know, privatizing Medicare, privatizing Social Security, things that will really affect our seniors. Donald Trump just passed a tax cut with $1 trillion added to the deficit, which did nothing to help working Floridians. So Florida needs someone who can stand up for Floridians, and I know that I can do that.
All right, thank you. You're fond of talking about using 2 years of free, mandatory public pre-K. We visited about that just recently. That has to come with a price tag, so please explain to me, what is that price? And how do you pay for it?
Well, first of all, let me say this. I have three young boys myself, 4, 6, and 8 years old. And I can tell you that one thing I've learned is that prior to third grade, kids learn to read. After third grade, kids read to learn. Right now in Florida, only 56% of third graders are at the third grade reading level. Why? Because they're showing up at kindergarten woefully unprepared. Why? Because we have not given them any kind of pre-K. You know, so basically my view is, education, your education life course shouldn't be determined by the size of your parents' paycheck or the zip code in which you're born. And so what we need to do is level the playing field. How are we going to do that? 2 years of pre-K. How are we going to pay for it? I'll tell you, because that was the question.
Yes, I should answer it.
Look, there's another statistic. What we spend as a percentage of gross state product, we now have a $1 trillion economy, the 15th largest in the world. What we spend as a percentage that is 38th in the country. 38th. And guess what? U.S. News and World Report says our public schools are 40th in the country. We need to just change the priority of how we're spending our money and start spending it on education.
All right. So let's talk about education and get specific about funding. When we look at the budget in Florida is already at $26 billion for education. So that's 29% of the budget. So healthcare is top. Education is next. That's two-thirds of the entire budget. If you're going to agree that those are top priorities in Florida, then where does money come for that pre-K program you're talking about?
It's a very good question. But, you know, I can tell you this. In the office, something called Executive Office of the Governor, it was $400 million last year. Guess what it is this year? $1.4 billion. He added $1 billion. You know what that's for? pet projects of the governor, like giving out corporate welfare to get some of these companies to create jobs that never last here anyway. So that money instead is going to be invested in our young kids. And let me tell you, the cost of pre-K education, this is not, there's been studies on this, and it's a 7-to-1 return. Because if they start out strong, they stay strong. So that money is there. It's just, we just have to take it from those other places. Another thing is, you know, Medicaid. We turned down the Medicaid expansion. It's costing us $500 million extra a year. That, again, can go for these little children. And I have to tell you, the day I get to Tallahassee, I'm going to fight to have 3- and 4-year-old pre-K education for every child in Florida.
So you mentioned that $1.4 billion that was kind of discretionary or whatever. As I understand it, just adding $400 to the per capita number, the per pupil number, would add $1 billion in the budget. So again, we're already $26 billion. It seems like a daunting task. If you have anything more to say on that, 30 seconds or less.
Look, nobody said it's going to be easy, but I can tell you it's a question of setting priorities. I mean, look, right now today in Florida, among 12th graders, only 19% of 12th graders in public schools are doing 12th grade math, and only 36% are doing 12th grade reading. These kids' lives are ruined. You know, how are they going to compete in the new global economy? You tell me. So to me, we don't have a choice. It's that simple. We're going to have to figure it out. We're going to have to educate our kids like every other state in the country does.
Yeah. So let me ask this. There's an axiom I saw on a local business marquee. Just driving up I-95, uh-huh. You might have seen it driving in today. It says, something you can give and still keep is your word. So we're talking about raising our investment and money. Would you give your word not to raise taxes if you're elected governor?
I don't believe we have to raise taxes because, like I said, it's just a question of priorities. We're 38th in the country in what we spend on education. We have to be top 10. We should be top 5 because we're so far behind, having failed to invest in our children for a generation. 20 years of Republican governors, look, they declared war on public education. The statistics can show us they've won the war. We have to begin a new war, and the war has to now be to educate our young kids. We have no choice.
You've obviously done well in business. I think the concern is that people say maybe the math doesn't add up. If we're not going to raise taxes and we still want to invest more money in some of those things that you're talking about, including education and a pre-K program.
Well, again, first of all, pre-K is probably going to cost, right now, let me tell you what we spend on pre-K. With the voluntary pre-K we have now for 4-year-olds, which is, you know how much they spend per child? $2,438 per year. So anyone in your audience, imagine starting a preschool for 20 kids and getting a total of $48,000 to pay all your faculty, your staff, your facilities, your supplies. It's silly. So what are kids getting in Florida? They're getting three hours a day of babysitting. And so we can do that. The money is there. That's the easy part, the 3- and 4-year-old pre-K. That will get that done. The harder part will be trying to get teachers' raises, which they need to get because, you know, our teachers are underpaid here, and communities cannot hold on to good teachers. They some of these communities, teachers come in. Look, last night I watched your debate with Adam Putnam. Now, Adam says he doesn't want to give any raises to teachers. Well, in his Polk County, I read today in the newspaper, they're among the lowest paid teachers, and they're short 100 teachers as school starts next week. So, you know, Adam, I'd say to Adam Putnam, Adam, we need to raise teacher salaries, and you have to stop telling us you don't want to do that. They pay $41,000 a year in Polk County.
Let me get one more question in here, and it'll have to be brief on the response. But we've got, you said that might be the toughest, is those things. We've got a Republican-controlled legislature. So if you're elected, how do you get your agenda through the House and the Senate if it's controlled by Republicans?
Well, Kent, first of all, you know, I've been very lucky financially, and I'm planning on investing my own money in my campaign, which I've done up till now, and I'll spend whatever it takes to finally go toe-to-toe with the Republicans, which no one's been able to do. The last election, we were outspent $120 million to $50 million, and we only lost by 1%. So I can tell you that I'm going to make sure there's money invested, so we're going to take back the Senate this year for good.
All right, Mr. Greene, thank you for your time. Appreciate it. That's all the time we have for this
okay.
Part of our forum, but thank you so much.